hug them. People don't like to talk about money. People think that you're not supposed to talk about money in church. God woke me up last night and said, "You need to not be afraid to release money on your people." He said, "Money doesn't bother me. Don't let it bother you." And so I got up this morning and taught on morning motivation on finances. It was awesome. Turn your Bible to Ephesians chapter 6. I want to talk to you tonight briefly about 7 tests. If you want the blessing of God bigger than what you can earn, there's a earning. You can earn a living, or you can design a life. Most people get stuck in a corporation and stuck in pleasing a boss and get stuck in working what they expect you to do, so they give you more hours and more of this, and next thing you know, you're literally slaving yourself out for increase. Now you're earning a living where God didn't put you here to earn a living. God put you here to design a life. Tell 4 or 5 people, say, design your life, design your life. So I want to talk about, there's 7 tests that will design your life. Band, you guys are awesome. Thank you. Give it up for the band tonight and what they do here. You are awesome, all of you. We love you, man. What, Sunday, y'all were rocking this place. They rock this house, don't they? Huh? Man, I wish I played some instrument. I'd get up there. I thought I could get up there with Johnny and bang on the congos a little bit. They got you stuck back there, brother, don't they? Where's Johnny at? They got you stuck back there. Nobody wants to see you. And you're pretty good looking, man. I need to have you sitting over here. Put some ugly folk over there. Turn your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 6. I want to read it to you out of the Amplified Bible. I want to talk to you about 7 tests. 7 tests you must pass if you want increase. How many would like to hear it? I like the Amplified Bible in this passage. If you're watching, of course, you're a part of Morning Motivation. I'm talking out of my book, Warfares You Must Win. This is April's Covenant Partner book. So as you sow your partner seed, I'll be sending this out to you. People have already been calling me up saying, "Oh my God, I'm reading this book. It's incredible." Be strong in the Lord. Ephesians 6:10. Starting in verse 10. Be strong in the Lord. What does it say? Be strong in the Lord. Amplified says, be empowered through your union with Him. Be strong in the Lord. How are you strong in the Lord? When you empower yourself in covenant with Him. The word union means covenant. Now, I believe a lot of people go to church. I believe few understand covenant. There's no release of the blessing of God just because you go to church. Look at somebody and say, you can love God and stay broke. Money's not a mystery. Money's not a miracle. Money doesn't grow on trees. Blessing isn't a mystery. I know people who love God but cannot get a blessing, because blessings are different than just going to church. You have to pass some tests. How many would like to pass some tests? Draw your strength from Him, that strength which His boundless might provides. Put on God's whole armor. What? Put on God's what? Put on God's what? Whole armor, not the part that's comfortable. Put on the whole armor, the armor of a heavy armed soldier, which God supplies, that you may be able to successfully stand up against all, and I love this in the Amplified, the strategies and the deceits of the enemy. For we are not wrestling with flesh and blood, contending only with physical opponents, but against the powers, against the master spirits who are the world rulers of this present darkness, against the spirit forces of wickedness in heavenly places. I like this part. Heavenly supernatural sphere. Therefore, put on God's complete armor, that you may be able to resist and stand your ground on the evil day of danger. And having done all. Look at somebody say, you got to do all. Having done all. Now watch this. I love this in the Amplified. Having done all that the crisis demands. Have you done did everything the crisis has demand from you? Have you ever been in a place where you've done everything you can do and it still ain't breaking? You praying, but it ain't happening. You believing, but it ain't turning. You're confessing and you still. How many of you get sick and you be praying healing and you still sick? It says you got to listen. You got to do something. Even after everything the crisis demands from you, here's what Paul said. You better do one thing. You better stand up. You can't not quit. You can't sit down. He said, stand firmly in your place. You got to hold your ground. Write down somewhere in your notes. When the crisis demands, hold your ground. Listen to me. You don't have to always make advancements to be victorious in the kingdom. Sometimes you just got to hold your ground. You don't always got to beat an enemy to be victorious. You just got to not let the enemy beat you. I hope I'm talking to somebody. You ain't got to always have a victory to be in victory. The victory is that the devil couldn't knock you down. Sometimes the biggest victory is not in you whipping the enemy, but that the enemy couldn't break you. He couldn't stop your praise. He didn't stop your seed. He didn't stop you going to church. He didn't stop you from lifting your hands. He didn't stop you from helping somebody. Sometimes your victory is not measured by your advancement, but your victory is measured by your willing to show up and just praise God. Sometimes God wants to see you just pass this. Can you just stand up when everything else has gone to hell around you? And throw your hands up and say, I don't have to have everything to tell you you're the God of everything. Better you throw your hands up right now and say, you're the God of everything. You're the God over every crisis. You're the healer. You're the deliverer. You deserve my praise whether I advance or not. When you challenge yourself to love God regardless of what comes from his hand, you will get so much what's in his hand, the devil will have a headache the rest of his life, if he had a life. I love the Amplified in this verse. I love it. Stand your ground. Therefore, put on God's complete armor, that you may be able to resist and stand your ground on the evil day of danger, and having done all, the crisis demand to stand firmly in your place. Don't give up your territory. Sometimes it's easy to give up when things ain't turning to your favor. Don't give it up. Don't give up your prayer. If you're praying for your children and they got worse, you notice when you praying for them, they get worse. Sometimes I think, maybe I ought not to pray for them. They seem to do better until I start praying for them. Then I start praying for them, they get more devilish and do stupid even better. But that's where God says, when it ain't turning into your sight, you don't give up your place in your prayer. You ever been on the phone? And I don't know what it is about phones now, but I hate calling any office because everything is automated. You don't get a human for an hour. They're even automated telemarketing. I love them. I just hang up, click. I ain't got to offend nobody. It's a computer. Hello, this is Verizon. Just using that because I saw you there. Click if it's a telemarketer. You know, we want to raise. Like today, man, I was in the middle of an important conversation. And I said, well, I don't know who this number is. We're moving. I better check it. And then there it is, telemarketer. I said, how y'all getting cell phones? The devil is a lie. But you ever been, I was calling the dumpster people because I got to put a dumpster out on this house. I'm remodeling this house starting next week. And I wanted a 30-yard dumpster. And I would call and a voice, a robot answers the phone. And then it says, do you need a dumpster? Uh-huh. Press 1. Are you a business? Uh-uh. Are you a resident? Uh-huh. Press 1 for business, 2 for residence. And I got so nervous, I hit 1. I went, oh, wait. Wrong one. How'd I go back? They don't care. Then they said, you're put in line. Your call will be answered in 1 minute. Okay. So I hear this beautiful music. I'm driving around. 1 minute go by. All of a sudden, a commercial comes on. Then commercial ends and it says, your call will be answered in 1 minute. And I went, oh, okay. I waited 1 minute. Commercial came on. And I said, okay, you're going to make me cuss here. I'm waiting. I was about to hang up. And then the lady said, your call, it will be answered in 1 minute. And every time she said that, my expectation went back up and I stayed on another minute. Y'all ever done that? And then it says, don't hang up so you can hold your place in line. Because you want to hang up and call back, right? You think about call back. I might get somebody. They say, oh, no. They already know how you think. Don't hang up because you ain't getting bumped in the line. You're already in line. That's what it says. Don't give up your place. So sometimes you're getting frustrated because it ain't happening. You're not getting answers yet. God said, don't give up your place in line and think you're going to start this thing over. Stand firm. Stay right there. Why? Because you don't know. You waited 10 minutes. Wait one more minute. Because giving up your place starts you over. And sometimes hell don't want to defeat you. He just wants you to give up your place so you got to. Somebody look at somebody and say, I ain't starting over. I dare you to say, I done stood this long. I done believed this far. I done sowed this much seed. By God, I'm going to stand until it comes. I dare 5 people to say, in my name of Jesus, I'm going to believe God for the increase. I don't care if your kids are cussing you out. You just stand there and say, and I ain't giving up my place. I'm going to slap you, but I ain't giving up my place. It's easy. It's so easy to let your flesh lead you in crisis and not your faith. It is so easy. It is easier to believe what you see than to believe what God is saying. Because what you see, you feel. What you see is real. It's in your now. But God doesn't live in your now. God is in your future. And so he's talking to your now. But when God talks to you today, he's got to talk to you in the problem, but he's trying to talk to you about the blessing. You don't see the blessing. You don't understand the blessing. You got to shift your faith and not give up your place. You got to hold your place. And your place is in the presence of God. Write this down. Your place is not your house. Your place is not the car. I don't care if the repo man's back in the car out the driveway. That's not your happy place. Your happy place is in the presence of God. And if God held back the blessing and let him come and get it, you don't know what he's driving back to your house. You don't know what he's planning. You got to hold your place. Amen? Look at somebody and say, hold your place, hold your place. That's why we need each other. That's why we need church. That's why hell is doing everything he can to water down the congregation. That's why we need life groups. That's why we need to do life together. That's why you need to quit being an island and you and your little family and start hooking up with other families. Why? Because we can hold each other better in place. A 3-4 cord is not easily broken. If Satan can keep you isolated by yourself in your home, he's coming after your marriage. He's coming after your mind. He's coming after everything. But when we get together, we start testifying one to another. See, we start encouraging. The church should be the most encouraging place you come. Look at 4 or 5 people, encourage somebody right now. Look at somebody and say, you're awesome. I don't care. Just lie. Just lie. Look at somebody and lie. Look at somebody and say, you're awesome. You don't like them? Look at them and say, I love you. Just lie. If you don't love them, lie. I love you. Look at somebody and say, you are an uncommon millionaire. I don't care if they walked here or drove a bicycle. Encourage somebody. You look at them and say, man, you got the pretty, I don't care if they got the sour face right now. Just lie to them and say, you got the prettiest smile. You look at somebody and say, you just look so young. I don't care if they look old, just lie. Encourage somebody. Don't put the hood up. You might get shot doing that. Look at somebody. Tell them, you're awesome, man. Come on, hug somebody. Put your arm around and give them a fellowship. Don't hug Christy. She don't look like she wants to be hugged. Okay, there you go. Hallelujah. Hug, Daddy, hug somebody else. That's your wife. Hug somebody else. Hug, that's your wife. Get up and hug somebody. Go hug Chris, Daddy. Go hug Chris Williams right there. Hug him. Go hug Chris right there behind you. Oh, Chris, get up and go hug him. He wouldn't even get up and go hug him. You see how we are encouraging in this church? He said, come over here and hug me. Did you see that, Jeremy? I said, hug Chris. He said, get up and hug me. You see what I had to live with? That's how we ought to be every Sunday. Man, you ought to walk. Some of y'all, I just going to be honest with you. I see y'all come in, I'm hiding. I get up behind something. I say, I know I'm their minister, but maybe somebody else will hear them. Because by the time you're done talking, I want to kill somebody. It's your life is so depressing, and you want to tell us. It's not like we ain't fighting our own demons. You want to dump all yours on us. No, when you come in here, you want to encourage and equip, and you want to exhort. You want to say, we can conquer anything together. Two of us together can send 10,000 demons. When we become a church that lifts up the name of Jesus, Psalm 68:1 says, let God arise, and every enemy of God will scatter. You don't have to ask God for anything if he arises. If God arises, the answer comes with it. The blessing comes with him. The healing is in his hand. He is the healer. What it said in Malachi, he said, but you that were faithful, he said, I know the wicked day is coming. He said, but you that were faithful, you that stood, you that kept tithing, in Malachi chapter 4, he said, you that kept praising and you that kept giving, he said, I'm telling you, the Son of Righteousness is going to arise with healing in his wings. He said, all you need to do is be faithful. Because when everybody else gets to losing it, he said, I'm going to arise in the midst of your presence. And he said, and when I arise, the enemy's going to run. Every enemy of God gets up and leaves. Cancer's running. Sickness is running. Poverty is running. Hate runs. Unforgiveness. It's all getting up and leaving. This is why you don't want to be just a trendy church, where all we want to do is worry about how you feel and how you okay. We want to ruffle you up a little bit and offend you. No. Because if you arise, all the enemies come with you. But if God arises, the enemy scatters. And I like that scatter, because it's like you ever threw something in a covey of quail? They just take off. Man, when God arises, demons you didn't know were hiding, we just take off. They just go. You didn't even know you had them hiding in the closet. They just come up and go. Things you didn't know were haunting you and tormenting you. And all you got to do is stir up the Holy Ghost. That's why Paul said, stir up your most holy faith. He said, why? Because God's attracted to it. And if he ever shows up, every enemy of God has to leave. That's why if you're comfortable, is this all right? If you're comfortable, now listen to me. You ain't never going to have prosperity if you keep hanging around with the ungodly. Look up here. I'm going to talk to you. I hope I offend you. I'm going to make you mad. If you don't pass the test of strife, let me give you my test. Y'all want my test? 7 tests. I like this stuff I'm talking about right now is awesome. 7 tests. Test number 1. I'm going to talk about it right now because each test produces a graduation. Okay? Each test you pass. Now, where did I get these from? Abraham. Because Abraham is the father of faith. Abraham is the father of the church, okay, that comes out of the blood of Jesus Christ. Why? Because the Bible says that Abraham's covenant is the covenant of the church. This is what people don't get. The Old Testament Levitical covenant was for the Jews. The covenant you and I are connected to is the Abrahamic covenant. The Abrahamic covenant is the covenant of prosperity. That's what people don't want to teach you, that the Bible is about prosperity. It is about everything you do the best in it. Everywhere you go, you ought to be the best. And when the presence of God is on you, you ought to be skillful. The Bible said that Saul was tormented by a demon and distressed spirit. This is 1 Kings 16, if you want to read it. And Saul was depressed, and the spirit had left him, and a tormenting spirit had come in. Anytime God leaves your atmosphere, a distressing spirit's going to come in. If you are distressed, somewhere you've run the presence of God off. All you need to do is find a way to get him back. Because the Bible says that they went to Saul and he was moaning and groaning and wrestling all night and distressed by demons. And they said, Saul said, I need a musician. I need a psalmist. And they said, there's a boy named David, the son of Jesse. And here's what the Bible said in 1 Kings 7. He is a skillful musician and worshiper. Anytime the anointing comes on you, and you, when you go back to work after you get the Holy Ghost, they ought to talk about you and say, you're the most skillful person here. You ought to be the best there. You ought to show, you ought to quit being late. Some of y'all dragging in, waiting for, and you ought to be early. Why? Because you got the anointing on you, and it shows your skillfulness. And he said, go get David. Why? He's a skillful musician. See, he didn't need any musician. He needed one that was anointed. Because the Bible said when David started playing that harp and worshiping, that evil spirit would come off of Saul. Hallelujah. This is for the blood of Jesus Christ. Just a good, skillful worshiper. And the devil got up and left and said, I'll come back when he done singing. I'll come back and distress you later. And so that every time Saul would be distressed, David would walk in and say, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall. And the devil said, I'll be back in a little while. I can't take him. Why? Because when God arises, even if God rejected you, God rejected Saul. But he didn't reject David. And so he said, excuse me, David's calling me. Yeah, but he's in Saul's tent. But I ain't going to see Saul. I'm going to hear David. But when he came in there to hear David, Saul benefited from his prosperity. Hallelujah. That's why the devil hates a Holy Ghost, Spirit-filled believer. Because when you walk in, even their demons got to leave. They won't even know. They'd be like, why do we always feel peace when you come in the room? Because I'm anointed. I got the God in me. You got the God of this world. I got the God who made the world. Oh, God, that's tongues, in case you don't know about that. That's the Holy Ghost. Well, I'm afraid of the Holy Ghost. You ought to be afraid of the devil. You afraid of the Holy Ghost? I don't know about that tongue. You speak with your tongue. You talk with your tongue, but you want to speak in tongues. You ought to be so full of the anointing that you stop everything. You just walk in and they stop talking. Why? Because you got the anointing on you. But I tell you, you better watch it, because if you're comfortable, if you got a friend who is comfortable in the presence of the ungodly, then you got to ask yourself, where are you with God? Oh, well, we better go on. I know somebody got really mad on that. Test number one. Every test you pass brings the next test. You don't go to test two until you pass test number one. And you don't get the test of the seventh test until you pass the sixth, the five, the four. Okay? So the first test that you got to pass, Abram had to pass it, you got to pass it. It will be the test of famine. The test of famine. The test of famine. Cool, what's that for? Is that for a guitar? That's pretty cool. I'm going to steal that. I need that for a sword. Where'd that come from? It's for a sword? Well, whose is it? Mine now. I've been looking for that. Richie, hide this. I'm going to steal it. Wait a minute. Is that a test? Oh, I can't steal something. I failed a test. Carlos, come steal this from me. Find out who that is. Tell him to sew it. Pass the test of famine. Test number one is what? Famine. If God wants to know what's really in you, he'll back off and let famine show up. Because your mouth starts talking when lack starts showing up. Your attitude changes when lack hits. I'm just trying to be real with you. Every time. Now, I got to tell you this because you know I only got a few more minutes and there's no way I'm going to get through seven of these. Not with all that good introduction. Famine is the test of attitude. That's it. When you don't get what you want when you wanted it, how do you act? Famine. Now, I got to tell you something about famine. Favor attracts famine. When you ask for favor, expect famine. Every time, it's in the Bible, every time God favored somebody, the next season from favor was famine. Famine was the qualifier for favor. The Bible said Jacob favored Joseph and famine showed up with his brothers. What you have to understand is that when God sends favor, he uses famine to do qualification. Okay, so famine is not just about testing you. Famine will reveal who's really for you. Famine, because people like you when you got stuff. But it's the real people who really like you are the people who can like you when you're going through some stuff. Monitor who stays with you in famine. They're your real friends. Famine will reveal who's not for you. So will favor. Favor will reveal who's really talking behind your back. Not everybody who acts like they like you to your face is liking you in your absence. And when you get favored by God, watch who gets agitated with your favor. Watch who gets jealous over your increase. When I talk about you and your blessing and I start seeing somebody start saying, yeah, but this, and I start saying, man, oh, April got a house and April got a brand new car, and I'm talking about April to somebody, and then somebody's like, yeah, but you don't know this about April. You know that. You already know that those people are not for April. They were for her until favor showed up. But famine. Now you got to watch it, because if you don't know your word in the test of famine, watch this. You will try to falsify a biblical seed. You won't sow a divine seed, you'll sow a manipulative seed. And the Bible said one time there was a famine, watch, and they took dove dung and they got the seed out of it and they put it in a sweat box And they tried to bring a harvest unnatural to the way you sow. They tried to manipulate a harvest their way and not trust God. The Bible said in this famine that a woman goes to her friend across the street and says, "Hey, we're starving." She says, "Yes, we are. Let's eat your son today and we'll eat my son tomorrow." That's what the word said. And that one mother kills her son and they cooked him and ate him like roast. The next day, they went to, the friend went over there to get the other woman's son for their meal, but she done hit him. She wouldn't kill him. So they took it to the king because the king had to sit, and they were bringing this argument before the king. And he rips his clothes and falls on the floor and gets in sackcloth because he said, because you have to be very careful, because in famine, you better watch who's trying to eat your future. You watch who comes up and starts telling you to eat your seed. We'll eat your seed. We'll eat your son. And then we'll eat my seed tomorrow. Because in famine, the most precious thing you have is your offspring, is your future. You got to watch church folk. Church folk be going there and eating. You be taking them to McDonald's and buying them Sunday lunch. And it's their Sunday, and they don't come. I know how y'all do. You think we don't know? Y'all won't work the when it, you come to church to be shouting and kicking the table. Then it's nursery Sunday for you. You sick. You got the God of the Holy Ghost when it's your, but when it's your nursery Sunday, you got every devil in hell show up. You can't even make it. You got to watch church folk. They'll eat your future. They'll suck the life out of you in famine. Let me tell you something else about famine. If God wants to find a lie in you, it'll materialize in famine. Abram lied in famine and called his wife his sister. Because he was trying to get some. See, you have to be very careful. In famine, watch that you don't chase wrong favor. And you start manipulating the situation to get favor from someone else. And start telling lies. Don't act like y'all don't tell no lies. You got to pass the test of famine. Number two, test number two. You got to, okay? Once you pass famine, you start increasing a little bit. The next test is going to be the test of strife. Once you get through the season of drought, now you got to get through the season of wrong people. God's got to see, can you walk away from wrong people? Now, I'm going to say this, and it's going to go against your grain a little bit. It ain't just your high school friends I'm talking about. It's a relative or a family member that keeps causing strife in you. Because the Bible said that they were getting, now they were increasing Lot. Abram was increasing and so was Lot. Now, God called Abram out. He said, Abram, come out from Ur. Come out. You and your wife, come out. He didn't call nobody else. Don't try to take friends with you in your assignment. Don't take people with you. When God's calling you and he ain't calling me, don't try to take me with you. Why? Because when we get there, I'm going to get blessed because of your overflow, but I'm going to create strife in your house. The Bible says Lot, his herdsmen started quarreling with Abram's herdsmen. And let me tell you something. You get strife in your house and it cracks a door to the demonic world. Because the Bible says strife, every evil spirit enters through strife. You should decide to look up strife and how many scriptures and proverbs are on a on a fool's mouth who creates strife. Monitor who enters your environment, and when they leave, you feel confused. They're saboteurs to your prosperity, to your joy. They have enough of God to go to church, but not enough of God to bring victory to your life. They're full of strife. Strife doesn't leave my body nor my mind if unforgiveness has found a house in my heart. If I have unforgiveness, I'll have strife in my house. Strife can enter through fatigue. You got to always monitor your rest. You have to take a pause in your life. You have to take off. You have to go off. You have to shut down and do something else. You can't work every day. Because why? Fatigue makes you strifeful. Because when you're tired, everybody irritates you. I'm tired. You see my red face? That means I've been out working. I'm tired, right? Pastor and I are moving. We got in a fight the other night, don't tell her. But we hadn't fought in a long time, but because we're tired, we got strifeful. When you're tired, everything irritates you. Just eating cereal. I'd be like, yeah, you got to eat the cereal like that? I mean, everything's magnified in strife. Y'all ain't gonna help me, are you? Y'all gonna just sit here and act like y'all? I know, Chris, you need to go on. You and Veronica don't ever have these problems. I read Facebook. My God, I told Veronica, I said, will you stop writing about Chris washing dishes for I have to? Keep that to your cotton picking self. When you're strifeful, when strife enters, it magnifies irritation. I mean, you'll be just sitting there and nobody doing nothing, you, especially married folk. Married folk ought to be like listening to me right now, because when you get irritated, you'll be sitting, I'll be sitting across the room, and everything she does just ticks me off, and she ain't doing nothing but sleeping. You got to snore like that? You got to breathe heavy like that? You got to scuff your feet like that? Turn the TV down. Get off your phone. I know you don't have that problem, Lupe. You just sweet all the time. But you got to watch her. We got in a fight, man. We was just like, and the demons, man, when you start growling at each other. Y'all ain't never had, you get some mad, somebody, you growl. And you trying to be spiritual, but you know it ain't happening. You know this about to go. You know it's like the old kicker out. We about to have a hold down showdown right now. If and now, get the guns. But Pastor gets. You know we're getting into it, man. But Roro's sitting there. Now Monroe, that's Pastor's sidekick, right? So Pastor got upset with me. Marianne got upset with me, right? And she got a little sniffy. Now, when the pastor starts sniffing, you better get up out the room. Because sniffing turns into swinging. 25 years of marriage, 29 years of marriage, and sniffing turns into Mike Tyson. Okay? Listen, pastor starts sniffing. And she walked into the bedroom. Now I'm standing there. Monroe walks over to me. Just staring at me. Let me show y'all. She goes. I mean, I was like, can I help you? That little 4-year-old. Like this, Jeremy, look. I mean, and then she said. Papa, you need a time. That was she did, Jeremy. She was like this. You need a timeout. You done made Nani upset. Well, that just cracked me up. But not Pastor, because he's still strifeful. Then when you in strife, you can't even say you're sorry. You go to hug somebody and they still strifeful. Baby, I'm sorry, get out of here. I go to hug, she says, I'm getting madder. I'm trying to hug you and tell you I'm sorry. I'm about to smack you in the face. You're full of strife. I done got Jesus in me and you still got the devil in you. We got to go to bed here and I can't sleep beside the devil. This for you, Daniel. Test number three. So now you got to pass this test of strife. So what did Abram do? That's not like Abram. He doesn't argue. He comes in and says, look, we can't stick together. He said, look, just go where you want to go. Pick any place. And he said, this is the kind of friend Lot is, or cousin Lot is. He says, I'll take the prosperous lands and the field with all the grass in it. You can have the desert. Now, that's the kind of friends you don't want to hang with. But you know what? God didn't bless Lot. God blessed Abram. So Abram said, don't matter. Because wherever I go, I got a covenant. The covenant was this. Wherever God sees my feet, he going to have prosperity under him. It says it in Psalms chapter 8. That God gave me the rulership over the works of his hands and put all things under my feet. Abram said, don't matter where. You need to decide where you want to go, because it don't matter where I go. And he said, I'm going to pick the prosperous land. He said, yeah, that might be good for you. You might need to go down there. Why? Because you don't got the covenant. I do. Because wherever I go, it's going to be all right. Put a praise on it right there. I got the covenant. See, you don't have, when you are the covenant carrier, you don't have to be in strife with anybody. You ain't got to argue with anybody. You ain't got to prove yourself to anybody. You ain't got to worry about how to let them do you wrong. Let them cheat you out. Why? Because when you leave, the blessing leave with you. I dare somebody to shout hallelujah. Glory to God. Look at somebody say, I'm a covenant carrier. I got to worry about you. Why don't worry about all that politician stuff and Democrats? Why am I a covenant carrier? Somebody, even, you worried about Russia? No. I said, man, I grew up through the Cold War and all. Think I'm worried about Putin? That name don't even scare me, Putin. Nah. Now Donald Trump up there, they scared of him. He's like, I'm going to push the button. Take me off. You're fired. I'm a covenant carrier. I don't want to watch the news. Why? Don't you want to know? I already know enough. I know this. I'm a covenant carrier. Do what you want to do, because everywhere I go, I'm going to be blessed. Everywhere I touch, everywhere my feet touch, I'm blessed. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. Look at somebody and say, you're blessed. Encourage somebody right now. Encourage somebody right now. Look at somebody and say, you're blessed. You better tell Daniel, tell somebody he's blessed. Tell Chris he's blessed. Tell Elon he's blessed. You blessed. Is that, who that back there? Kevin, you're blessed. Is that Kevin back there? You blessed. Encouraging him. Anybody can run like him is blessed. Never met somebody brag about, I run 37 miles. I said, I hate you. and you know what? I know he got Jesus, because he got a smile on his face on the finish line. I walk this walk around whatever pastor's taking us on. I ain't got no smile by the time we're done. Ain't no Jesus in me. 3 miles and Jesus left. I don't know how they did 7 miles to Emmaus. I couldn't do 3. I say, Jesus, we got to take a rest here. 7 miles is too long. You better write your message in 3 miles. Pass the test of strife. Number 3. Pass the test of warfare. Abram had to pass the test of famine. He had to pass the test of strife. He had to get rid of Lot. Let him go. Let that people go. Let him go. Number 3, now he got to fight war. Because you can't have what you ain't willing to fight for. Why? God's wanting to make a partnership with you. And I'm going to tell you something. God don't partner with cowards. According to Revelation, the Bible said, but the cowardly, the ungodly, the abominable, the immoral, the liar, this is what God said, shall all have their place in the lake of fire. So God put the coward in the same fire with the wicked. I got to know you're going to stand up for me. Now go down there and fight. And the Bible said that Sodom came up and took all the peoples behind the back of Abram and took them back down there, slave them. And Abram got us all his herdsmen and said, let's go. We got to go down here and fight Sodom. And the Bible said he went down there and whooped him. Why? Because he's a covenant carrier. See, when you got God in you with covenant, you can fight some folk and God going to give you the victory. He said, go down to Sodom. Now, Sodom in the Hebrew is a type of Satan. So he's a Lucifer character. So he's a type and shadow of Lucifer. And the goal of Lucifer is to take people. And he takes the people. And Abram goes down there and he whoops the guy, beats him bad. The Bible said took all the people, not just the ones that he took, all of them that were in captivity. He set them free and then took all of Sodom's money. Now, up to this point in Abram's life, the only God he knew was a God with a voice. He knew a voice. That's it. All he's been following is what he's been hearing. He's never seen God. But as soon as he got increase, as soon as he battled in warfare and had victory, the next test was sitting there. Because he's coming back. Now he's loaded down with increase. This is not in. Now look. This wasn't increase from God. Because Abram had been already wealthy. This was increase from the work of his hand. This was Abram's ability to increase himself. God doesn't attach tithe to his hand. He attaches tithe to your hand. If you earned it, you owe a tithe. If it come from your ability, that I gave you the ability to have the victory. If I gave you the victory, do you know how to tithe? Abram's coming back loaded down. And Melchizedek shows up. Notice that God doesn't show up until there's a tithe to give. When Gideon was hiding behind a rock, the Bible said, A mighty angel of the Lord, but a lot of theologians believe it was a type of Christ, because he comes down and Gideon, and he says, what are you doing, mighty man of valor? Come out from behind that rock. And Gideon was so moved by it, he says, let me get you an offering. That's what he said. He said, I won't even talk to you till I give you a tithe. And the angel, which is a type of Christ, the Bible said, sat down and said, hurry up and put everything on hold to wait on the tithe. That's how important it is to God. You think it's just some little 10%. You think it's just something we got to do to pay the bills. It has nothing to do with that electric bill. That's what churches try to reduce it to. You need to help us pay the bill. You need to help us, you know, carpet. Tithe has nothing to do with carpet. It has nothing to do with lights. It has nothing to do with sheetrock. The tithe is the test of the window. The tithe is, do you qualify for more? Or do you just want to keep learning how to earn it? The tithe takes you beyond the earner because you're a learner. You learn about the tithe. How does Abram know to give him a tithe? Where did it come from? Who taught him that tithe? Because it goes all the way back to Adam. Adam taught the tithe to everybody. That's why Abel knew what to give God. Cain didn't want to do it, the Bible said. The tithe has been established by God. It's a covenant. It's a test. And Abram hasn't seen his God yet. He's only heard him. But as soon as he found out there's a priest called the Most High God, he said, hold a minute. I got a tithe for you. I didn't know that the voice I heard had priests that served him. And immediately said, I got a tithe from you. And turned and gave a tenth of Sodom's wealth to Melchizedek. Hallelujah. Now, Satan got upset. If you want to really make the devil mad, start tithing. Because as soon as she started tithing and gave that tenth, Sodom shows up. Satan always answers when God speaks. You better watch when God talks. Satan's going to talk too. And if your feelings aren't, if your faith's not grounded, your feelings will lead you. So most of you are not tithers because you're feeling givers. You're not faith givers. And the Bible said that Sodom comes back and says, listen, Abram, you beat me, you whoop me. It's a good thing. It's all right. Listen. Keep all my money. She said, keep all my money, but give me all my people back. He said, you have my money. I didn't come to fight you. I just want my people. Not your people. The people that were mine before you got there. They were mine. And Abram looked at him and said, no. I ain't giving you people and put them back in bondage. He said, but I do have something for you. And the Bible said he went in his tent and got all of the wealth left of Sodom. He said, but I am going to give you back all your money. And he takes all the 90% left. He said, here's it all, but the tithe is gone. He done cut the tithe. Here's the 90 and gave it back to Sodom. He said, and then what he said, lest you go bragging that you made me rich. That's the key to covenant. I would rather not have a dollar if it gives Satan credibility to brag on me. I'd rather live in a tent and have God bragging on me than does Satan going around behind my back saying, they got that because I gave it to them. He bought that because I gave it to him. He said, I don't want nobody like you going around saying, you made me rich. Now, God shows up, middle of the night, wakes up, get up. Get up, Abram, I'm changing your name. He said, what you going to change my name to? Abraham. And the word ham in the Hebrew is ruach. He said, I'm about to give you what hell can never give you. My spirit. You holding on to that 90. God said, it ain't never going to give you what Yahweh could give you in one ham. I'll breathe on you. Boy, Abram sat up and he said, God, he said, Abram, you've impressed me, son. I have. You didn't know my desire was the people. You gave up the money to keep the people. You know I'm about people. I'm going to die for the people. You didn't keep the money. Then you said a braggadocious thing. You said, lest he made you rich. Do you want me to make you rich? That I could brag on you? He said, get up from this day forward. Abram, this day forward. From here on out, I will be your salary and your compensation the rest of your life. He said, you ain't never gonna worry about money. Oh, you might have to fight some people now, and you gotta overcome some things. You're gonna have, there's some Isaacs in your future. But I'm gonna tell you one thing, you ain't never gonna sweat over another day in your life, a dollar bill. You're gonna always have the money. I am gonna become your salary. I mean, I'm gonna pay you everywhere you go. Money gonna follow you, and I'm gonna compensate you for everything you gave up. You gave up the 90, I'm about to give you a thousandfold return. And then he said, and I'm not done. He said, you're not done? He said, oh no. I give you money. Money's the easiest thing I can give you. I own it all. I can compensate you, give you pay raises, pay off your house. It's nothing to me. But I don't give this out cheap. Okay, what? I'm going to tell you the God who's more than enough. He said, that's all you got to know. Next time the devil knocks on your front door, tell him El Shaddai is going to answer you. The God who's more than enough. But you can't love the money and love the God of heaven and earth. Abram proved it. What tests? I'm done. I told you I won't get through 7 tests. I got 4. 5. Okay, I got 3. Test of warfare. 4, which I just gave you the story. Test of recognition. 5, test of finances. That's the tithe. I just gave it to you in a story. Those are I just led you through the story of those. Warfare, recognition, finances. He recognized God. Melchizedek. He recognized him. And then he tithe. Tithe is the financial. Seed has nothing to do with finances. I know people who like to sow but don't pay tithe. But here's the problem. If you're sowing but you haven't tithe, what you said was, it's not about you, it's about me. Because seed creates harvest. Tithe has nothing to do with harvest. Tithe has nothing to do with you. It's you recognizing God with 10% of every increase. That's it. God set it up. I didn't. Tax season just came, and some of us, we had to give the government more than 10%. I don't see us not doing it. Man, what if you did your IRS bill like you do your tithe? You know what that means, right? Going to jail. He recognized God. He tithe. 6, the test of timing. I don't have time to teach that. 7, the test of release, the seed, Isaac. The last test for Abram was Isaac. The hardest thing you'll do. Let me tell you something. If you can't tithe, the hardest thing you'll ever do is give up your Isaac. Tithe is a tenth. The Isaac is everything. Isaac is the thing you love the most. Can you give it to God? Isaac's the hardest thing to give. It's why it's the last thing you do is the Isaac, is your seed. It's the last thing on the test. And the test of timing, the millennials are failing. Because the test of timing is proven in 3 areas. The test of timing is proven, number 1, in marriages. If you can't go through your marriage, you can't pass the test of time. When you're in a covenant with another human. It's tested in your money, timing, and your relationships. They're all proven through relationships, through marriages, through your giving, or through your how you earn money. Money. Money is a current. What do they call money? Currency. If you don't understand this about money, that's if I got me. I got some money, okay? My favorite. Right there, and I ain't giving it to nobody. That's it. I didn't have it till today. I went to my new house. I was working on my new house, putting stuff in the shed. A lady come out there and she says, is that a Jeep thing? I said, uh-huh, it's a bikini top. She said, you used to have a Jeep? I said, uh-huh. I said, you like it? She says, I do. I said, I got a winch too that does the hard top. She says, really? I said, give me $375, you can have them. 1, 2, 3 and 75. That's all I had. That's all I had. She kind of filled it up. I didn't even have it in my money clip. My money clip was hiding over there. It couldn't, and she gave it to me. But it, you know what? I said, I get money to you anywhere I need to. I said, oh, hallelujah. But see this? you know, I could take a match and burn this right here. You know what it'll do? It'll burn. You'll cry, but it'll burn. Now, I ain't burning it. I ain't stupid. But it's got no spirit on it. It's like, it's got the devil. There ain't a devil nowhere. It's too thin to have a devil. It's nothing. It's a government's. The government of a country gives it its value. Now you sell your life for this. You go to work and work 8 hours a day. You work 8 hours a day. When you go to work, what time do you have to be at work? What time? A.M.? God, I'm glad I'm an entrepreneur. 7:45 a.m., you got to be at work. What time do you get off? After 5. Then you go to Steinmart sometimes too, don't you? I like you at Steinmart. And then you go to Steinmart. That's your second job, right? Okay. So what do you go there for? This? Huh? You don't go there to say, Lupe, thank you for coming over here and putting shoes up today at Steinmart. We just love you for that. Oh, thank you. That's all I did it for was an affirmation. No, she did it for this, right? So let's say I'm going to hire her. I'm going to give her $100. I'm going to say, I'm going to hire you. I'm going to give you this per hour. Okay? $100 an hour. Okay? Is that not enough? You're awesome. Okay, Rico, I'm going to hire you. I'm going to give you $100 an hour. Okay? I'm gonna need 8 hours, okay? That's $800, right? Exactly. Listen now, but what he don't realize is he just sold 8 hours of his life to me for $100 an hour. That means I own you for 8 hours. Now, some of you think you're only worth minimum wage. Okay, so I sell you, that's slavery. You're selling me yourself. Okay, now, you get this $100, you worked 8 hours, you got 800, and you go over here to Walmart, and you buy that TV. It took all of your money to do it. Your $800, you gave it. A TV took 8 hours of your life to get it. That means that TV became your life for 8 hours. Put that to a car or a house. And the next thing you know, you have debt. Because the taskmaster says, the house cost you $100,000. You don't have that, do you? No. But I'll sell it to you at an interest rate, and you can pay me $400 a month for 30 years. When you pay it off, the $100,000 house is $300,000. I made $200,000 because you sold me your life. You know you could work 25 years, pay for that house, and not pay the last 5 years, and they can take it from you. And they'll take it, and they don't even feel bad about it. Because we get up every day, and we're stuck in debt. And we go to work to pay what? Debt. We go to pay bills. So you go to work to pay your bills. That's why you don't have more than just enough money to pay your bills. You've been imprisoned to debt. You get up with debt on your mind. You don't go to work for money. You go to work because you got debt. But you got to shift your thinking tomorrow. When you wake up, you don't go to work to pay your debt. You know what you go to work for? Increase. You start shifting your value to not being imprisoned to debt, but imprisoned to increase. I go to work to increase. While I increase, I buy things. Next thing you know, God starts increasing you because you ain't a debtor. God doesn't want you to be a debtor. He said, I paid a debt. You couldn't pay. You owed a debt. I knew you couldn't pay it. I'm such a God of increase. I came down and paid your debt and killed myself to free you from debt. But you run out here every day. Did you know I was talking to a car guy, and he says, oh, man, I can't wait. What? He said, tax season. I said, what do you mean? He said, refunds. I said, what do you mean by that? He said, you have no idea how many people are going to come down here and give us their refund check as a down payment to drive a car and be in bondage to a payment. I want to decree and declare we pass these tests. We got to go. I want to decree and declare we pass these tests. I want to decree and declare that you become the people of increase, not the people that go to work for debt. You don't pay your debts. You're increasing beyond your debts. I'm living bigger than my debt. I'm worth more than my debt. Somebody say that in the name of Jesus. I'm worth more than my debts. I'm going to work to increase myself so that I can be the overflow in the house of God, in the world, for God's people to know I'm blessed going, blessed coming. I do not live for debt. I live for increase. How many live for increase? Shout amen three times. Stand to your feet. Let's go home. Let's go home. How many like tonight? Did you enjoy it? Did you enjoy it? Hug somebody. Bless somebody. Tell them, I like it. I'm going to pass these seven tests. It's in my book. You can read my book if you don't know it. If you're watching, thank you for being a part of our church. We love you. We hope you walk in the fog, the favor of God. We'll see you Sunday. I can't wait as we release one of the last statements of Jesus on the cross. It is finished. Somebody shout, it's finished in Jesus' name. Talk to you later, guys. Take us away.